Hi everyone, in this video lecture we will talk about isoquants. So isoquants is a very commonly used term in production theory, and when we talk of production theory, what usually happens is that capital and labor or any input is used to produce some amount of output. So say that capital and labor are used to produce some units of a good. So there are various combinations of capital and labor. So let's understand this by an example. So if an entrepreneur is operating a firm and he uses 10 units of capital and 40 units of labor, then by combining these two, he can produce 100 units of output. So 40, 10 is one combination. So there are 40 labors in such a firm and 10 units of capital that is employed to produce 100 units of output. Another combination that is possible is 30, 15. Means now what is happening is that I'm reducing my labor by 10 units. So my labor units is going down and then my capital units is increasing. So what is happening is essentially I am saying that labor you go away and I am substituting that labor with some capital. So I am increasing the quantity of machines that I'm using in a factory and I'm limiting the amount of labor that goes into my production. Now with this combination as well, I am able to produce 100 units of output. Then again, now another combination is C, that is what is happening now. I'm reducing my units of labor by more. So now I'm telling my 10 units of labor, you go. And now what I do instead of them, I employ some machines, I go to the market, I buy some machines and increase my capital consumption. So that goes up by 10 units. So you can see that I have written delta L and delta K, which we will discuss later on. Then we come to point D. That is now what is happening is now I tell my 10 units of labor, you go away, and then I go to the market, buy more units of machine, my capital is again going up and my labor is again going down. So what is happening is that 100 units of output is produced using different combinations of labor and capital. So it doesn't really matter that which combination is there in an economy, whether I am at A, B, C, D. What really matters for an isoquant is that the number of output that is produced is 100. So if I join these points A, B, C, D, what I get? I get an isoquant. Similarly, for a Q is equal to 200, there would be some combination of L and K. And if I join these combinations, I get these isoquant. Similarly, for Q is equal to 300, I get one more isoquant, which is this one. So this was what is all about an isoquant. Now let's discuss the concept of MRTS. So in a normal economy, so generally in production theory, what we assume is that these isoquants are downward sloping and convex to the origin. We will not go into the technicalities in this video. What I'm going to explain is that why it is happening, that what is the nature of MRTS, that is the marginal rate of technical substitution in this case. So the formula for MRTS is delta L by delta K. It is given by this formula. So to understand MRTS, you can look at the second table given here. So for calculating the MRTS, what I've done is I've calculated delta L and I've calculated delta K as well. So when I move from 0 to A, what is happening? There is a change in my labor. So labor is changing from 0 to 40. So for the first point, I would treat it as undefined. So there is no MRTS for point A in this case. For the time being, I am ignoring this. Now, when I move from A to B, so what is happening is I am traveling down an isoquant. So the change in my labor is given by 10. The change in my capital is given by 5. Then, so we know that MRTS is defined by delta L by delta K. So if I take this ratio, it is 2 for this case. Now, if I move from B to C, I move further down. So for this, my change in delta L is 10. My change in delta K is again 10. So if you see, I'm talking about the movement from this B to this C. You can see from 30 to 20, the change is 10. From 15 to 25, the change is again 10, and if I take the ratio, it is 1. Then what happens is, now I'm moving from C to D again. Now when I'm moving from C to D, my change in L is 10 and my change in K is 15. If you don't understand that how I've got these, so look at these terms. So when I'm moving from C to D, the change in L is 20 to 10, that is 10. Change in K is 25 to 40, that is 15. So all I'm doing is I'm taking a ratio of delta L upon delta K, and it gives us the MRTS. And also note that if instead of L, I would have L here, K here and L here, then my MRTS would have been given by delta K by L. But here, what I'm doing is that I'm assuming L to be on the y-axis and K to be on the x-axis. So this was the concept of MRTS. So if you see, this MRTS is falling, and due to this falling MRTS, my isoquants are convex to the origin. And why are they downward sloping? They are downward sloping because in order to, when my L is increasing, so you see, when I'm moving from this, then my K has to fall. So one input is increasing, one has to fall to keep the output constant. So that is why isoquants are downward sloping in this case. So it simply means that if I'm increasing one input, so what would happen is, if I keep the other input constant, my output would rise. To stop that from rising, I have to reduce the quantity of other input. So that means isoquants would be downward sloping, and since MRTS is falling, my isoquants would be convex to the origin. So this was isoquants. If you have any doubts, post it in the comment section, and if you like the video, do hit the like button. Thank you so much.